time. So our second talk is Srinivasan and Kumar. The title of the talk is A Framework for Resilience Measures and Catastrophic Shift Systems.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. My name is Venkat, and I'm a PhD student from Illinois. And today we're going to talk about how we can develop some framework for resilience measures in the context of a catastrophic shift system. I'm going to give you a few examples of what catastrophic shift systems are in real life, in nature. So the top left figure is a classic case of eutrophication in lakes due to nutrient loading. So if you have a nitrogen or phosphorus loading into lakes, it causes algal blooms. And typically, if you look at shallow lakes, these algal blooms prevent sunlight from reaching the plants that are in the lake bed. And so those get killed, off. And that prevents the fish that feed on the algae. So you have a tremendous algal bloom, and the state is completely changed to a clear state to a very turbid algal bloom state. And it's very tough to go back to the clear state. Even if you decrease the concentration of nutrients, you still will not be able to go back to the original state because you already killed off all the plants that give refuge to the fish. Another classic example is desertification. Like, once you clear cut a forest, the system is very different in a sense that you have topsoil erosion, there is not much infiltration, and you have a barren land, and it's very difficult to go back to this by planting a few trees. It will never allow you to go back to the original state. I mean, and similar examples in woodland and grass scenario, where the grasses are stabilized by fires and grazing, whereas woodlands are resistant to fire. So once you have a woodland, then it's very tough to go to the grassland, and once you have a grassland which is well stabilized by fire, it's kind of tough to go back to the woodland. So these are some examples in real-life scenario that talk about resilience and in the context of catastrophic shift system. Let's look at the dynamics. Let's look at the equations that govern this. I mean, you would be surprised. This is a very simple equation. It's a third order in X, and it's a simple differential equation. And this is able to capture the essence of the behavior of the system. And here I'm plotting dx over dt as a function of X on the x-axis. So immediately you can see that there are three points where where the velocity or the rate of change of x becomes zero, and these are what are called as fixed points. So if you start your x here, you will be staying here no matter what, because it's dx dt is zero. Same is here and here. Now if you look at the stability of these points, let's say if you push the particle from here to the right, the velocity is positive, so dx dd is positive, so it's going to move away towards the right. If you push from here to the left, dx dd is negative, so it's going to move to the left. So the center point, which is the circle, is an unstable fixed point, so it's going to repel things away from it. Whereas these points are stable fixed points, they're going to be attractors, so things are going to go towards this point. So whenever you start to the left of this line, you are going to reach somewhere here. Whenever you start to the right of this line, you will reach here. So these are called what are called as domains of attractions or of these fixed points. And you can also think in terms of potentials. Like the bottom figure is a potential well, and these are clearly bistable systems. So if you kind of imagine a ball here, it's going to go down the slope and be here, and over here is going to go here. So same thing. So the bottoms of the well are the stable fixed points, and the peaks are the unstable fixed points. And to put some meaning into these parameters, you can think of if X is, let's say, fractional cover, vegetation cover, or something like normalized vegetation cover, theta 1 is like rate of deforestation or reforestation, and theta 2 is like intrinsic growth rate of plants, vegetation, how fast it can grow and recover. And theta 3 is the nonlinear term that creates all the magic. Now, this is a plot of how parameters can change and introduce different dynamics. So again, the dark circles are the stable fixed points, and the white circles are the unstable fixed points. So there is a region for parameters where you have a bistable system. And if you take a cross section, you go back to the familiar double well potentials at the bottom. So if you take A, B, and C cross sections, you find these double well potentials. Now let's say, and if you assume that theta 1 is some kind of a deforestation or a reforestation parameter. So negative means you're cutting down trees, positive means you're putting more trees. So let's start somewhere here in the curve. So you slowly decrease theta 1, which means that you're cutting down more trees. Your fractional, your vegetation cover changes a little bit, decreases a little bit, but it's okay, it still decreases. But over here, and if you decrease your, if you put, cut down more trees, you have a drastic change in your tree cover. So things are not, for a small change in theta 1, you have a much higher change in the fractional cover. This is what is a catastrophic shift thing. And another interesting thing is, if you move from here to here, you move a little bit, but if you go back, you are still able to recover to the original state. But if you move from here to here, you go down here, but if you increase, if you plant a few more trees or decrease the rate of deforestation, you don't go back to this state, you are still at a very low state. And in order to go back here, you need to move all the way up to this and then push the system up. So that is the hysteresis effect associated with this. And these are pretty interesting phenomena, which is kind of self-stabilizing in their own local domain. Now, the question that I'm trying to ask is, which system is more resilient or more vulnerable? So these points are more vulnerable to domain changes compared to over here. If you're here, you're less vulnerable to changes in domain, whereas if you're here, you're more vulnerable to changes in domain. How do we go about quantifying this? Can we say that this system, if you're here, it is more you're more vulnerable to changes to here? I mean, things like that. So I'm developing some quantitative measures for that. This is a framework that I use, and one thing is fairly trivial, fairly obvious, that you need some kind of a disturbance event in order to talk about these things. If you have a steady state, things are not going to move. So you have to have some kind of a change. And you can either have a single disturbance event, give it a one kick, or you can have a series of disturbance events which can be conveniently modeled as noise. And here I consider two noise, a Gaussian white noise, which is a non-correlated noise, and a dichotomous noise, which is a two-state process where the transition between the two states are exponentially distributed. Now, the key point about for trying to formulate a resilience measure is to develop these well-posed questions. So unless you have a well-posed question, it's tough to get answers. And more often than not, when people talk about resilience, the difficulty with quantifying is they are not able to get to a well-posed framework. So these three questions, I think, will help to zero in and get the focus. So resilience of what? We are looking at change in dynamics. You go from a wet state, like a forest, to a barren land. And resilience to what? So what kind of disturbance? Is it a single disturbance, or is it a Gaussian white, or a Markovian dichotomous noise? And resilience in what? And the particular aspect of disturbance, aspect of resilience is important. I'm going to talk about that in the next slide. So let's look at for example, a single disturbance event, like just give it one kick. So this is a double well potential, so you have these two stable points and this is an unstable point. How much kick do you have to give if you start from here, how much kick do you have to give to push the system beyond this? That is captured by this delta X1 term, right? And over here, delta X1 is smaller than delta X2. So you have to give a bigger kick if you are in the second domain of attraction than if you are in the first domain of attraction to undergo a change. So that is what I call as an ecological resilience measure. And I'm plotting this as a function of theta 1 and theta 2. So if theta 1 is biased, so if theta 1 is negative, so which means that you are cutting down trees, so you are favoring the lower value compared to the upper value. So this value will move here, which is why you have a higher resilience as you go down over here and lower resilience as you go up here. And this behavior is inverted to the second domain. So and the second type of resilience measure that we can come up with is how much kick does it take in the vertical direction. Like this is in terms of activation. You can think in terms of activation energy and like chemical kinetics and things like that. So a system may be very far off from the unstable point, but the well may be very shallow. It may be a shallow well. So and that I capture here. So if you see, if you compare these two figures, they look very similar, but If you spent a lot of dollars trying to change your deforestation to reforestation, you definitely increased order of magnitude the ecological resilience, but the activation energy is very small. So although you made the you separated the distances, it's still very shallow. So it depends on what choice you want to make. Do you want to in order to effectively choose what you want to accomplish? And here this talks about recovery rate, how fast your system recovers. So for lack of time, I'm going to skip that. And go to more interesting stuff, which is noise-driven dynamics. So let's subject our system to noise, and this is an example of Gaussian white noise. And we are interested in terms of stationary PDFs. So this is a stationary PDF of the same problem, and you see a double peak, so bimodal distribution. And these peaks corresponds to the wells, the bottom of the wells. These are, if you want to compare the modes of these things as stable fixed points, kind of, and the anti-modes, which are the troughs, are the unstable fixed points. And similar to the domain of attraction concept, you can define a regime concept, which are separated by these low probability zones. So you can come up with several measures here. One is a switching frequency, how frequently does it switch between these two domains, or you can talk about regime probability, like probability of finding a system state in one regime versus another. So these are just few examples of the suite of measures that you can come up with. So If this is a plot of theta 1 versus theta 2 and different levels of noise, and you can see that as the noise increases, there's more diffusion. But what is kind of counterintuitive is when you increase the noise, the less favorable regime, right? So it favors the less favorable regime. So if you look at here, for a low noise, what is very highly resilient becomes less resilient. And if you just look at the region below, what was very low resilient, which is dark blue, becomes more resilient. So resilient noise is actually favoring the less resilient regime. So these kinds of concepts can be brought out using a quantitative measures. I'm sorry, can I go back? Yeah, you could clearly see that from these PDFs. So here you have a sharper peak, whereas for a higher noise level, you have a much blunter peak. So, okay, now the more interesting stuff comes when you use dichotomous noise. So this is a noise scaling parameter as a function of x. And as you change the noise, what happens is, and these are the PDFs, you can see that there is structural changes in PDFs. And this is what I call as noise-induced bifurcation. So when you have a structural change in the PDF, then you have what is called as a bifurcation. So when you go from low noise to high noise, you have changes in the number of regimes. So the white circles are the unstable points, and they determine how many regimes you have. So here you have 1, 2, 3, and 4, whereas here this entire region gets lost, so you just have 1 and 2. And here you have recover that, so you have 4, and here again you have 3. So not only is the regime probability is decreasing, the regimes themselves are getting extinct, and then they come back. So these are pretty interesting things. So for example, if you have a very stable ecosystem over here and you slowly start increasing noise, you move up this line, and after a critical threshold of noise, you suddenly jump here. And then if you increase noise, you still go, you can explore all this region, but when you start decreasing noise, you go back here. You can never recover this this region back. So if you think in terms of climate change induced increased variability and things like that, there may be ecosystems which can never be recovered because of just by increasing noise. Even if you go back to decrease noise level, you will not be able to recover. So these are pretty interesting things that you can come up with in terms of getting these quantitative measures out. So I'm not sure how much time I have left, but I'm just going to say that these are pretty interesting figures that you can have bifurcations in dichotomous noise and not Gaussian white noise. And I'm going to go to the conclusion very quick. The conclusion is that we have three questions that we want to get out in order to get the framework for resilience right. So we have to ask, resilience of what? We are interested in change in dynamics. Resilience to what? whether you have a single disturbance event or multiple disturbance events, or what kind of disturbance events, and resilience in what aspect, whether you're looking at ecological resilience or activation energy or regime probability or regime size and things like that. If you want to explain to a layman, I would try to take these two examples. Now, if you're reaching out and trying to get a fruit or something, you can either jump and try to get the fruit, or you can use a long stick. Similarly, if you want to accomplish domain of attraction change or a regime change, you can either spend a lot of money and a lot of dollars trying to push the system out, or you can change the well. You can make the well narrow, or you can make the well deeper, and you can easily accomplish these changes. So I will stop here and leave it with that. Yes, thank you.
Great. I think we're going to move on without questions to the third talk. Great. So the third talk is by Genevieve Ali et al., and the title of the talk is Hydrologic Connectivity for Watershed Process Understanding, Brand New Puzzle or Emerging Panacea. Genevieve?
Hi. Good morning, everyone, and thank you very much for being here. Before I begin, I just want to mention that what I will be presenting today is mostly built upon my past PhD work, plus one specific example for my current postdoctoral work, and therefore I need to acknowledge my PhD advisor, André Roy, also my three postdoc advisors, Odorite Tetzlaff, Chris Soulsby, and Jeff McDonald, as well as all the members from the NordWatch project team, so the Northern Watershed Ecosystem Response to Climate Change project team. So I guess I should start by giving you the definition of hydrologic connectivity, which I'm going to work with today, which is the ability of a given watershed location to transmit water, nutrients, etc., all the way to a watershed outlet or a lake. And the great thing with the connectivity concept is that it's been embraced by the wide majority, which is what I call the panacea factor. So there's much excitement on the science side, with an exploding number of connectivity papers that are published in ecology, hydrology, and geomorphology. There is also a shift in the way we assess watershed systems. So instead of primarily focusing on which watershed locations are receiving water, we're explicitly looking into reasons why some locations do or do not transmit water to their surroundings. So basically, we're studying how surface topography, soil characteristics, and antecedent wetness conditions interplay to determine whether a watershed location will act as a catalyst to flow or rather as a barrier to flow. And there is much excitement on the management side as well when it comes to using connectivity or disconnectivity as an effective tool for flood defense or diffuse pollution control. So the connectivity concept is even being alluded to in official documents such as the EU Water Framework Directive or the US Clean Water Act. Now, on the other end, we have a few issues to deal with when it comes to connectivity, and these are what I call the puzzle factors. So the biggest issue of all has to do with upscaling. So the most prominent studies on connectivity so far have been conducted at the plot, hill, slope, and small catchment scales. So basically in small, pristine environments rather than in large, inhabited, and disturbed watersheds. Another challenge is that recent studies on connectivity have predominantly focused on temperate, forested environments with strong topographic controls. But that means that some of the types of environments have been largely under-investigated so far. And that's notably the case for snow-dominated watersheds, pothole landscapes, and urban areas. Besides, as things stand right now, we're not really in a position to determine large-scale connectivity thresholds, which would be of use for management or jurisdiction purposes. So what I'd like to do today is to give you three examples of connectivity study approaches, which were first implemented in specific environments, and which I believe could be applied to other places as well, with minimal changes. So what I'm mostly interested in today is the transferability of each approach to larger scales or to different climatic regimes, and the potential of each approach to be integrated into a watershed management framework. So the first approach is the one I refer to as data greedy, because it basically relies on high-resolution measurement networks of water table data or soil moisture data. So here what you have are maps of saturated areas in a very tiny temperate forested catchment, the Hermine. So the Hermine catchment is located just north of Montreal, Canada, and it drains an area of approximately 0.05 square kilometers. And on those maps, the black squares represent the saturated areas, the gray squares represent the non-saturated areas, and the red circle shows the location of the catchment outlet. So instinctively, you would tend to think that runoff generation is directly proportional to the actual catchment area that is saturated with water. However, within the connectivity assessment framework, we do not so much care about the actual catchment area that is saturated. We rather ask if the water from the saturated areas can be transmitted all the way to the watershed outlet. And we can use a wide range of connectivity metrics, which basically rely on topographic information and percolation theory principles in order to answer that question. So here, I skipped all the mathematical developments associated with connectivity metrics because I just want to show you what we usually end up with. So in a nutshell, a connectivity metric can tell us over which average distance there is a continuous path of soil saturated conditions from a given watershed location all the way to a watershed outlet or a lake. So for example, here for the amine catchment, you have the connectivity distance plotted against the average soil moisture content. So there is a sigmoid-like relationship between the two variables, which means that in general, the wetter the catchment, the longer the connectivity distance. And here you have the amine catchment discharge plotted against the connectivity distance. And it's interesting to see that there is a connectivity distance critical value over which the discharge values are significantly higher. Some points do stand apart from that relationship here, but they can be easily explained by a difference in antecedent wetness conditions. So the connectivity metrics approach can be affirmative, but the greatest downside of it is that high-resolution measurement networks are impossible to deploy over large areas. And so there seems to be little future for connectivity metrics when it comes to large inhabited and disturbed watersheds. I would however argue that maps of saturated areas or soil water content can be obtained more or less directly either via remote sensing images or by using proxy variables such as soil type, vegetation cover, etc. So this might be a way forward when it comes to large watersheds. A great advantage of connectivity metrics is that they're flexible enough to allow the effects of human landscape features to be taken into account. And so by human landscape features, I mean roads, dams, or pieces of farming equipment that can either favor or impede the flow connectivity to the outlet. And other advantages are that so far connectivity metrics have proven to be scale independent, and we're finding new ways to reduce the computation time associated with the algorithms. Now, the second approach is a more parsimonious one in the sense that we swap spatially distributed measurements and connectivity metrics for geochemical tracers and mixing models. So I'm using the amine catchment example again, and here what you have is a map of catchment elevations above the catchment outlet. So when we ask the question, where does the water observed at the outlet come from, we can actually answer it in two different ways. So from a lateral point of view, we can pinpoint riparian, midslope, or upslope areas, which are color-coded in blue, yellow, and red on the map here. And from a vertical point of view, we can discriminate between overland flow, shallow soil layers, or deep groundwater sources. And discriminating between the sources is rather easy when we can identify specific geochemical hotspots. So in the amine catchment, we've been using major anions and cations, but also trace metals to be able to infer which catchment locations transmit water to the outlet and exactly when they do so. And we've been using mixing models to do that. So mixing models are not new, but applying them to data collected in contrasted conditions is seldom done. So we decided to rely on different scenarios of wetness values and discharge values to be able to evaluate how runoff sources changed with hydroclimatic conditions. So in the tiny amine catchment, when conditions were dry and discharge values at the outlet were rather low, we could only capture the signature of deep groundwater sources. However, when conditions were wet and discharge values at the outlet were high, we observed that stream flow was fed by mineral soil layers from upslope areas and mainly organic soil layers from riparian and midslope areas. And it was actually interesting to throw trace metals into the mix because we relied on a specific combination of them. So for example, cobalt, rubium, yttrium, I think it's selenium and strontium. And these trace metals allowed us to learn that two swampy and seemingly non-flowing areas were actually able to transmit water all the way to the outlet during those wettest conditions. And in addition to being able to name the sources, we could also evaluate their relative contribution to the flow that was observed at the outlet. So When we looked at a wetting up sequence in Dermin catchment, we observed that the relative contribution of overland flow was only 0% in dry conditions and it jumped to 20% in wet conditions. Also, the relative contribution of riparian organic soil layers was only 18% in fairly dry conditions and it jumped to, I think it's 71% in the wettest conditions. So this approach was interesting in the sense that it allowed us to make a time variable qualitative and quantitative assessment of connectivity. Now, with regards to the transferability of that approach, the great advantage is that tracers are known to integrate multi-scale process variability, and that, of course, makes them perfect tools for upscaling. Tracer studies also perfectly suited to investigate diffuse pollution problems, provided, of course, that we can somehow associate each potential pollution source with a distinct geochemical signature. And so for large watersheds for which long enough water quality data records are available, we could easily come up with different scenarios of wetness values and discharge values to be able to infer time variable runoff sources. So basically do exactly what we did for the smaller Hermine catchment. Now, the third and last approach is the one I call data limited because it's basically the approach that we're stuck with when we only have precipitation and discharge data available. So the background is that the relationship between precipitation and discharge is often a nonlinear one and basically takes a precipitation threshold to be exceeded for high discharge values to be obtained. Below the threshold, the degree of catchment scale connectivity is generally assumed to be low, whereas above the threshold, it is assumed that a high enough degree of connectivity has been achieved so that storm flow can be routed all the way to the catchment outlet. And so quantifying catchment-specific precipitation thresholds can be seen as an indirect way to approximate the timing of connectivity within those catchments. And that's what we attempted to do across 9 Nordic catchments, which are located in Canada, the USA, Scotland, and Sweden. So those catchments have drainage areas from less than 1 to 30 square kilometers. And basically, we decided to use both a visual procedure and a mathematical procedure based on spline functions in order to identify the thresholds. So threshold values which range from 26 to 81 millimeters across the sites. I should point out that some of the threshold values were uncertain because of all the scatter present around the bend, like in those examples. But we made sure that from a statistical point of view, the precipitation discharge response below the threshold was significantly different from the precipitation discharge response above the threshold. So this work was exploratory, but I already think that we could expand this threshold-based approach to larger scales for three different reasons. The first reason is that the use of a mathematical approach or spline functions could now allow us to identify thresholds even from large multi-year data sets, so the data sets that we usually have for larger watersheds. The second reason is that we found no correlation between the actual threshold value and the whole watershed area, and so this seems to suggest that there's no real scaling effect. However, we found out that threshold values were strongly correlated with the median subcatchment area and also with the median flow path distance to the stream. So basically, threshold behaviors were strongly correlated with catchment organization measures. And that seemed to suggest that we could use easily available precipitation and discharge data together with simple VM derivatives in order to characterize the connectivity-driven threshold hydrologic response of a watershed. So, if I try to synthesize all of this here, I'd say that combining the benefits of multiple study approaches is great, not only to define reference watershed conditions, but also to predict future ones. Hence the potential, and I really insist on the word potential, of the connectivity concept for understanding human natural systems and their response to change. So improved connectivity metrics could be key to understand hydrologic transport in larger river basins. When it comes to tracer studies, they're particularly helpful to pinpoint sensitive watershed areas. And by sensitive areas, I mean areas which are problematic not only because of the local geochemistry, but also because of their potential to be connected to the outlet. And when it comes to thresholds, while they could be seen as an original way to approach non-stationary time series analysis or extreme events prediction as well. So, both connectivity metrics and tracer studies can provide us with a spatially anchored framework via which to look for watershed restoration solution, while thresholds are rather helpful when it comes to the temporal aspects of watershed management and jurisdiction. So the multiplicity of study approaches really makes connectivity a versatile tool, and this table here illustrates the kind of large-scale connectivity-based watershed assessment framework that I think that we should be aiming for. We're not quite there yet, of course, but I think that we're heading in the right direction, especially if we focus on the scale-independent or easily scale-transferable connectivity assessment methodologies. So, yes, that's where I stop. Thank you very much.
I think we have time for one question. So I have a question, Genevieve.
That's fine.
So as a non-expert in connectivity theory, can you tell us about, you know, one can think about connectivity in overland flow paths, connectivity in subsurface crack pathways, connectivity in the actual valley bottom system in between, you know, sort of confined and unconfined or distributary flow. Can you apply connectivity theory without specifying that, you know, which type of process, or can you apply it in all three ways and then sort of aggregate at the end? How do you do that?
Yeah. That's actually a great question, because I think that at the beginning of my talk I said that I was going to give you the definition that I was going to work with today, and this is the only definition that I could find that made no assumption about underlying processes. So it was basically the definition which aimed to capture emergent patterns rather than focusing on specific processes. So the answer to your question, in my opinion, is no. So far, you can actually find almost as many definitions as there are papers published on the subject, depending on the dominant process that it actually assumed for specific sites. I think we're still quite far from a unified process-based definition. So, yeah. Thanks.
Thank you very much. So our next speaker is Ann Jefferson, and the title of the talk is Channel Network Extent in the Context of Legacy Land Use Flow Generation Processes and Landscape Dissection. And I want to see a question after this talk.
All right, so I'm going to be picking up on the theme of how humans have sort of a lasting imprint on landscape form and also on the connectivity theme, because when we talk about where channels are on the landscape and how water is routed through the system, that's really the connectivity that Genevieve was just talking about. So I'm going to be telling you a story of a specific place, but I want to start out by talking about what we know about the controls on where channels should be found in a watershed. And there's been a lot of work over the last 20 years on the problem of channel initiation, and we see in a variety of landscapes that it's generally a function of the upslope drainage area, contributing area, the local slope, and then some function of the surface properties, things like vegetation, roughness, soil properties, things like that. There's also some work that suggests that it is mediated by the flow generation mechanism. Is your flow coming from saturation overland flow, infiltration overland flow, or subsurface storm flow? But generally, we can simplify a whole lot of equations down to something of the form where some threshold constant, which is those surface properties, is at a particular landscape, and then area and slope to some power. And typically, in forested, relatively undisturbed watersheds around the world, including and some disturbed watersheds, that X exponent is on the order of about 2. Okay, so my question is, how do channel networks recover from disturbance where there may be changes to both that threshold constant and possibly that exponent as well? And we can think about this in the context of sort of network extent versus time. So if you have a system that's running along at something like steady state and disturbance, in my case, human agriculture, comes along and changes the channel network, what happens when that disturbance goes away? Does the system immediately begin to recover? Does it exist at a new steady state for some time and then begin to recover? Or have we permanently changed the extent of channels on the landscape? So I am going to be working in the North Carolina Piedmont. I think if you wanted to find a landscape that should have been at steady state pre-1700, you couldn't find a better place than the North Carolina Piedmont, because basically since the end of the Appalachian Mountain Building, it's just been sitting there. There's been no glaciation. It's a warm, humid climate. We're relatively low relief in slopes, relief on the order of 150 meters over this whole area here, so local hill slopes and then a broad regional slope. Local hill slopes are on the order of about 15%. It's tectonically stable. We have old fractured crystalline rocks and very thick loamy soils, particularly thick clay B horizons. That you can see a lot of red Carolina red clay there. That's about 2 meters of red clay, and that isn't even down to the bottom of the B horizon. All right, and so we're going to be specifically looking at some watersheds in this context and entirely forested areas, or at least entirely forested right now here in 2011. But anywhere you go in the Piedmont, there is a very strong land use legacy. Basically, there are no old growth forests in the Piedmont. It was all harvested and then used for farming, intensive cotton and general farming, beginning in about 1750, peaking after the Civil War, and ending in the early part of the 20th century. Now, this was before the days of erosion control practices, so you had extensive sheet wash erosion from the uplands, gullying, and then in the larger river systems, you had significant floodplain aggregation. Cotton prices declined, system changed, and a lot of these places were simply abandoned and forests regrew in them. So in some places you can see very explicitly this legacy land use effect in that the gullies are clearly still on the landscape. In other places, you have to look a little bit harder to find that land use imprint, but if you turned around from where I took that picture, you would see some old rutted road tracks moving through this landscape. This is a particularly critical question because I think we're on the cusp or into the next phase of disturbance in this landscape, in that the Piedmont is being very rapidly urbanized. So understanding what it was like in the agricultural days, what it's been doing since then, and what it was maybe like before that is extremely important. So just to think about then, the things that are controlling your channel network extent are your land surface properties and your flow generation mechanisms. So based on inference and historical documentation, we know that pre-1700 it was forested. Our flow generation mechanisms were likely subsurface storm flow, saturation overland flow, and maybe in extreme rain events some laminar infiltration excess or Hortonian overland flow. Likely our channel initiation function had a form with an exponent of about 2, again based on studies in other forested areas. Then in the agricultural period, you had bare soils denuded. The sheet wash erosion basically destroyed the A horizon. And we have lots of documentation of infiltration excess overland flow, maybe laminar, maybe even turbulent in some cases. Gullying studies in agricultural environments around the world suggest a variety of channel initiation functions, sometimes of sort of a critical shear stress exceedance form, sometimes no area slope relationship whatsoever. In the present day, again, we're forested. We investigated flow generation mechanism at 6 channel initiation sites and then mapped 100 channel heads in these forested watersheds. All right. So just the field observations, the channel heads were entirely within valleys and hill slope hollows, not up on the planar and convex slopes, in watersheds that were entirely forested. In areas that still have human land use of agricultural urban form, we do see gully heads and channel heads up on planar hill slopes. We don't see any evidence of overland flow above the channels. We get a thick leaf fall in the fall, and those things don't move around outside of the channels over the course of the winter. We also see really contrasting channel initiation morphology. Here we can see in some places we have head cups up to 3 meters deep. In places where there are roads or ag practices, in forested watersheds, our average depth at the channel initiation site was about 20 centimeters on average, about 1 meter wide. So that suggests that there's been some relaxation of the channel head morphology, possibly some downslope migration of the channel initiation position. So where do these things fit in on the landscape? This is an example of one of our field sites. All of the circle square combinations represent places where we map channel heads. The outlines represent the small watersheds that contain those channel heads. So we use the LIDAR data we have for the field area to look at things in slope area space. So every pixel in the watershed gets plotted up on a plot that looks like this. And then you typically infer some different process domains at different slope area spaces. A lot of this sort of work's been done in steeper landscapes where you have debris flows. We have no debris flows in the Piedmont. All right, so this is an example of one of our slope area plots. You can see we have a pretty clear region of convexity, which is hill slopes, and then this strong tailing off of slope with increasing area, which is representative of alluvial channels. This is where our channel heads plot up at this particular field site. So you can see that there's also this region in here that represents unchanneled valleys. These are the hill slope hollows and valleys upslope of where our channel initiation occurs. One more example of this where it gets a bit more complicated, and we see this at about half the sites. Again, we have hill slopes and an alluvial channel region. But then there's this bigger region here in the middle where you have to do some other inferences. So again, we see a region of slightly decreasing slopes with increasing areas, which corresponds to the unchanneled valleys. So all of our channel heads are at greater areas than that. But then we have this region of about constant 15% slopes. Some channel heads in there, but also some unchanneled bits. And so I think we have a differentiation between unchanneled valleys and then possibly an aggradational wedge where slope wash deposits filled in these valleys, gave them a pretty consistent slope, but there was not enough shear stress and stream power to initiate gullying in these areas. So that's sort of an example of what this part of the landscape might look like, right? So you can see sort of a gentle slope in there, but no channels. In terms of the flow generation mechanisms, we monitored for 8 months at 6 channel heads. We had soil moisture reflectometers and crest stage gauges both within the channels and upslope of the channels. We actually never saw any overland flow or saturation upslope of the channel heads. We did see flow and saturation in the channel heads itself. And during very wet field days, we observed macropore flow within and downslope of channel heads, contributing flow into the channels. We got flow in 8 events over the course of the year, suggesting that these are not entirely relict. They are actively functioning channels on the landscape. But we did see more frequent flow downslope of the channel heads, suggesting that the upslope most extent of the channel network is not as hydrologically active as farther downslope. And now finally, the 100 channel heads that we mapped, the colors correspond to our 6 field areas. And if you fit an area slope relationship through the data, you can see that our exponent, our best fit exponent, is 1.27. Remember, the expected exponent for forested watersheds is around 2. The range at individual sites, 4 of our 6 sites, had statistically significant exponents, which ranged from about 1 to about 1.5. So again, none of our sites showed an exponent of around 2. Just here is the best possible fit with an exponent, a forced exponent of 2. You can see it does not fit the data nearly as well. Here's one with an exponent of 1, which we might expect in a gully landscape if it's just exceedance of critical shear stress. It fits the data reasonably well, and I'm still working on calculating some fit statistics there. But again, our best fit is someplace in between. So this suggests that the flow generation mechanisms that we observe in the field today, which are typical of forested landscapes, this subsurface storm flow, potentially some saturation overland flow, do not correspond with the initiation locations we observe, and that maybe there is some recovery of channel extent from the sort of equation we might expect to find in a gullied landscape. Maybe it's on the way back towards a forested landscape. So just to summarize in my remaining 15 seconds, the Piedmont watersheds, we definitely do see evidence of historical gullying, but there's a lot of ground-based and some channel initiation evidence that the forested areas are recovering, and this is much more recovery than we see in watersheds with continuing human impact. But there is no strong topographic signature of dissection related to this historical land use. If anything, there's maybe a signature of aggradation and deposits in the unchanneled valleys and hollows. And finally, that the slope dependence for channel initiation or the overall channel network extent differs from what we'd expect to find if this were an undisturbed forested watershed. So if we go back to the conceptual figure here, again, we think this is something what it might look like pre-disturbance, disturbance. We see evidence of recovery, so this is not our trajectory here. We're not maintaining channel extent. So the question is sort of where we are here, and I would suggest that what we are seeing is a very slow recovery. Now, obviously, we're only observing one point in time across a couple of locations, so we cannot distinguish between these different trajectories here just by looking at the extent of the channel network. We need to use other measures to understand the persistent effects of the historical gullying in this environment, but I still think that this is a useful framework for understanding the potential recovery of disturbance and whether we are in a catastrophic shift ecosystem like one of our previous speakers was discussing, or whether this is a self-healing landscape that over time will return to the sort of channel network we'd expect to find in an undisturbed forested system.
Question for Anne.
Yeah, I don't think you could see that in my photo, but there is now some A horizon. It's quite thin, on the order of 15 to 20 centimeters. I don't know exactly how thick A horizons would have been at these field sites pre-disturbance. We don't have great pre-ag information for our specific field sites, but on average, the southeastern Piedmont lost 30 centimeters of topsoil with the agricultural period. So I don't think our A horizons are back yet to what they were pre-disturbance, but it looks like the flow generation mechanisms are at least trending back towards what the historical records suggest they were like pre-agricultural disturbance.
Great. So our next speaker is Patricia McDowell, and the title of the talk is "Sedge as a Mediator of Channel Change: The Special Case of Carex denudata."
Thank you. Well, I'm going to paint a picture about really an in-member case of vegetation channel interactions. The study area is in northeastern Oregon in the Blue Mountains, and this is an area where this very special plant, Carex denudata, is found. This plant has the ability to occupy active channel beds and reshape the active channels in gravel bed rivers. What I'm going to do in the talk today is first just briefly discuss some of our models of vegetation channel interactions, then talk a little bit about the unusual characteristics of Carex denudata, tell you about how Carex denudata has spread in the study area, and then talk about the geomorphic effects. In the traditional model of vegetation channel interactions in gravel bed rivers, both fluvial system influences and vegetation influences are recognized, but really it's the fluvial system influences that dominate. The fluvial system controls the substrate, rips up vegetation, provides germination sites for the vegetation. And in most gravel rivers, we think of vegetation as just affecting specific microsites within the system, adding bank strength, maybe adding roughness in particular locations, but it's really a minor effect relative to fluvial processes. Around 2007, Kornblit and others introduced this fluvial biogeomorphology model where they more explicitly place vegetation on a par with the other two controllers of the system, and they more explicitly recognize these two-way pathways of influence between the components. And this is a really useful framework for allowing us to evaluate the relative effectiveness of these three components. Carex denudata occupies areas within the active channel of these gravel bed systems, right on the active cobbles and gravels, and it can also grow in cracks in bedrock, where bedrock is exposed in the channel. The life form is a very dense tussock. The base, which is predominantly the root mass, is commonly half a meter in diameter, and sometimes close to half a meter high. Once the leaves come out early in the summer, you see this large sort of 2 meter diameter tussock for a mature Carex nudata out in the middle of the channel. The root mass is extremely dense, a very fine network of roots. They're very tough roots and very resistant to erosion. So under high flows, this root mass really behaves like a boulder in the channel. So it's in effect, we're planting boulders in the channel when these things spread into the system. The clusters of nudata trap fine sediment, and it's also been recognized that they create patches within the channel where other species that are less hardy then come in and colonize and begin to stabilize those surfaces. Here's an example of a Carex nudata that was uprooted during a flow event, transported down, and deposited on the channel. And you can see the leaves coming back out on top, and you can see that hardy root mass. When they're transported, they apparently behave like mud balls. And when they're deposited like this, they will resprout where they're deposited. The dislodgement rates are really low. They're very tough. Levine, working in Northern California, found that he had about a 0.5% dislodgement during a 10-year flood event. Last summer, last May, we had the flood of record in the Middle Fork John Day over the 80-year discharge record. And when we were out there in July, there were really very few dislodged nudata that we saw in the system. So, you know, very high percentage of them, well over 90%, probably well over 95% survived that flow event. Here's another example of a nudata that was picked up out of the channel and transported and deposited up on sort of a high bar, low floodplain surface where it hasn't resprouted. There was some active overbank gravel transport there, but you can see the root mass on the right side of the figure there. So I did research out in this area in the middle 1990s, and there was very little evidence of nudata. It was really very low on the radar screen. When I started working here again in 2008, the systems were dominated by nudata. So we're looking at the same site here in 1996 with an old dead cottonwood. In 2008, the cottonwood has fallen down. We're looking down the same channel, and you can see it's completely lined by nudata. There was a gravel bar just to the left side here that has become stabilized by nudata. And when I looked back at my 1996 photo, I see that the nudata are there, but they all have buzz cuts due to cattle grazing, and there's very few of them. So those parent nudata have flourished and spread. And by 2008, they're very widespread. I felt like Captain Kirk in the Tribble episode of the Star Treks. These nudata were just falling out of the sky and just completely swamping everything. In aerial photos, there are three distinct channel positions that we see them occupying. And each of these positions has different effects. Lines right at the edge of the channel bed, right at the edge of the gravels at the base of the bank. Nudata colonizing along bar edges. And then clusters or individuals of nudata getting set up right out in the middle of the channel. So we're going to look at each of these individually. These are some examples. This is an air photo where we see a continuous vertical line of nudata all along both edges of the channel bed. This particular reach is a very simple trapezoidal channel. The river was channelized during dredge mining in the 1950s, and you see some of this disturbed mine area back here. So this is a very unactive, stabilized channel, and the nudata has just set up shop right along the edges and completely controlled the channel edges. This is more of a natural reach, and we see a more discontinuous line of nudata at the edge of the channel. And right behind it, you see that white patch of scoured bank erosion behind the nudata line. This is what that looks like on the ground. Here's the line of nudata, and here's that eroded bank behind it. And it appears that the nudata may set up a secondary flow structure during high flow events that actually creates erosion behind the nudata. Here's another example of that. And so I hypothesize that this might be leading to channel widening as nudata begins to occupy the middle and the edges of the channel. Here's a shot that shows an example of a formerly active point bar. This was a bare gravel bar in the 1990s, and nudata has colonized all along the edge of it. And then other sedges and graminoids have come in and occupied that gravel surface and stabilized it. This site also shows a mid-channel bar or island of Nudata, probably started by a cluster of Nudata right at the upstream end here. The Nudata typically occupy mid-channel, kind of right at the end of the pool in the beginning of the riffle. And so this large structure in the middle has actually split the flow into two flow paths. Here's another example of a mid-channel cluster. Again, we're right at the end of a pool and at the beginning of a riffle, and the flow has been diverted over here to the left side, and there's bank erosion and channel widening as the Nudata occupy the center of the channel. And here's an example of one of those in the middle, right at this boundary between the pool tail and the beginning of the riffle. The Nudata also affect bed topography. Here's a cluster of Nudata in the center of the channel, and there's a scour around it. This may eventually lead to undercutting of the lead Nudata and uprooting and dislodging the lead Nudata. But they're clearly affecting the bed morphology. And there are other examples of bed morphology effects. So let's look at these three positions and what they do. The line at the base of the bank does tend to stabilize the edge of the channel bed, but it also appears to create these secondary flow lines that may lead to channel widening and maybe eventually shifting of the channel into a new position laterally. These lines at the edges of the bar lead to colonization and stabilization of the bar surface by other sedges, and that bar ceases to become an active source for gravel transport downstream. And finally, these mid-channel groups tend to split flow, and they, in some cases, lead to the growth of a mid-channel island and stabilization of that feature. They also can lead to complex bed topography and scour around the Nudata, which may be a negative feedback effect. So if we go back to the biogeomorphology model, here's a case where vegetation is really a dominant player in the system, and some of these effects that were grayed out, that were kind of thought to be the more subtle effects, are really some of the dominant channel shaping effects in this system, all as a result of the elimination of cattle grazing. If we hadn't eliminated cattle grazing from this reach, we would have a completely different model of what these channels look like. What the Nudata is doing is shifting it to a new channel form, and I'm not sure exactly what the endpoint is going to be yet, but it's increasing complexity, leading to multi-scale channels split around vegetated islands, more complex bed topography. It appears to be reducing sediment transport in the reach. It may also have some effects on transport of large wood because it's creating points where large wood is going to hang up more. It is highly resistant to fluvial disturbance. Even the flood of record did not significantly change the morphology of these features in the channel. It's got impacts for fish habitat. This is a reach that's actively undergoing restoration. The main restoration strategy is placing wood structures in the channel. At the same time, this sort of unobserved process, the advance of Nudata, is going on and reshaping the channel. I would argue that maybe we could do without the wood restoration and just let the Nudata have the next decade in this channel, and it may do all the restoration for us without any significant investment. Okay, thank you for your attention, and if there's any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. I would like to acknowledge my supporters here. Thank you.
Questions?
Well, to me, it's special. I haven't seen another species that actually has the ability to occupy and survive on the active channel bed. We're also doing some testing now of root strength and root density and things like that, and it'll be interesting to compare that with published values for other species in the literature. But if anybody has another species that behaves like this, I'd really like to hear about it. It would be a lot of fun to exchange ideas. It occurs in California in the Coast Range and foothills of the Sierra. It's up in northwestern California. It occurs in western Oregon. It just gets into the very southern bit of Washington State. It's mainly in western Oregon, but there are a few rivers in eastern Oregon where this study area is where it's found. So it's a limited distribution. I haven't looked at that at all. Yeah, so I don't know. And of course, there's a lot of other manipulations going on in this system, like withdrawals for agriculture and then buying back agricultural water rights. So it would probably be pretty hard to detect.
I just have a quick question. Mm-hmm. So you mentioned that the Carex behaves like a boulder. So if you were to advise a numerical model, for example, about Manning's roughness, mm-hmm. is it exactly like a boulder? Could one take the Manning's N appropriate for boulder-rich channels, or is it more subtle than that, do you think?
I don't know. That's the next step we want to do, is try to do some quantitative modeling of the effects. Okay, very good question.
Thank you, Patricia. Our next talk is by Kyung-sung Yu. The title of the talk is Thickness of Weathering Profiles Relaying Tectonic Signal to Biogeochemical Cycles, and this is an invited talk.
Thanks. Thanks for the invitation, and I'm switching the gear here from the stream processes to upland the hill slopes. And I'm going to talk about an ongoing study in the Feather River in Sierra Nevada, California, and that the work is highly collaborative, and it involves multiple collaborators from multiple institutions, and then it is currently going through the active stage of research. How do I move to the next slide? Okay. So I'd like to begin by going over the basics of morphological evolution of hill slopes in response to channel incision. So when channel incise at the base of a hill slope, then the local slope gradient at the hill slope becomes steeper. And as slope becomes steeper, then the colluvial sediment flux increases and removing the soil mantle at a faster rate. And so as soil thins out, the soil production rate increases and the hill slope evolves toward the new steady state morphology. But if you zoom in on the hill slope evolution processes, then we see that many aspects of hill slope evolution is not currently well understood. And for example, even though we made a significant progress in empirically quantifying the soil production rates from the bedrock to the soils, and we still don't know, how the actual process of soil production operate at the field, and then we have poor knowledge and what factors really control them. So following the physics-only models that Cliff Riebe and his co-workers and published a series of groundbreaking work, and they basically they were able to empirically and quantitatively relate the total denudation rate, also production rate, to the chemical denudation rate in the soils. And this work led to another series of work where the researchers related the soil production and sediment flux to the chemical denudation rate in the soils, and this work also allowed us to quantify the chemical denudation rate as a function of hill slopes. So where do all those advances in recent years place us when we consider the entire and the whole weathering profile in the context of landscape evolution? And then my goal of today's talk is to present a case that such a question is an important one if you really want to understand landscape response to tectonical forcing. So the study site is at the Feather River, and the Feather River has been downcutting the Sierra Nevada basalts over and creating about 1 kilometer relief over the past 4 to 5 million years. And this is the LIDAR-based plan view of the basin. And then several studies showed that this plateau, which has been sharply incised by the Midfoca Feather River, has been eroding at a rate of 2 to 20 meters per million years. And in contrast, there are studies showing that the channel has been, the river has been incising into this landscape at the rate of above 170 meters per million years. which is a lot faster than the erosion rate at the plateau. And then there are also studies showing that the erosion rate on the sub-catchment area of the rivers have been about the same with this river incision at the Mid-Fuku Fed River. So I'm going to show you some of the channels in this sub-catchment and the channel profiles. And this is the stream profiles of those tributary watershed. And then those streams have been having hard time and catching up with the incision of the Mid-Fuku Fed River. And those streams have one or multiple nick points. And above nick points, we have a hanging valley. And below the nick points, we have in the watershed that comprise the very steep hill slope. And some of them are not soil mantled and they become more apparent to the Mid-Fuku Fed River. So I'm going to go into this Bold Rock Basin. And this is the oblique view of the Bold Rock Creek Basin. As you can see, there is one nick point at the head of this channel. And above this nick point, we have relatively subdued landscape. And for example, at the pond site, our 10B analysis suggested that the total denudation rate is about 30 meters per million years. And an FT and the BRC site, which are close to nick point, we found about erosion total denudation rates range from 130 to 300 meters per million years based on our 10B analysis. But across all our sites, the elevation gradient is not significant enough to have any kind of systematic vegetation changes. So we were able to hold geology and climate and vegetation virtually identical across those sites. So this is the pond site above the nick point. As you can see, the hill slopes are still very steep, but then the landscape is covered with the soil materials, which color are very red, and which indicates the significant presence of weathering-derived iron oxide, and that the valley is filled with the sediment. And now we are moving to FTA and BRC near the nick point. The hill slopes are obviously steeper, and also you can see that soil colors have changed, so it doesn't really have the significant presence of iron oxide, and the valley is no longer sediment-filled, and the bedrock channels begin to emerge. So here I begin to talk about the weathering thickness, starting with colluvial thickness. So by soil thickness, I mean this, the depth reach of the biophysical disturbance and mixing. So soil thickness in this case is equivalent to the depth to the lower boundary of physical mixing and is also equivalent to the depth to where saprolite physically breaks down. So we defined the soil thickness that way, and then we determined soil thickness based on our field observations of color and texture, etc. But then those depth measurements turned out to be largely in good agreement with OSL-based estimate of the mixing layer. So basically what this data shows is that the quartz grains that have zero OSL ages, which has been exposed to the sunlight and thus to the ground surface, and they are present to the subsoils, and then that the percentage of quartz that have reached the surface, though, decrease with the depths. And likewise, the quartz grains with infinite OSL age, which is the indication of the saprolite materials, and they also present near to the surface, even though their percentage decreased toward the surface. And so there is a presence of a mixing, and the mixing depths based on the field observation are in good agreement with the OSL-based estimate. So now, based on our conventional model of soil thickness and soil thickness change over time because of the unbalance between soil production rate and erosion rate, and if we also assume that soil production rate decreases with the soil thickness, then we are supposed to predict that the soil thickness decrease rapidly with the erosion rate, and we would expect to see the bare bedrock landscape at FTA and BRC near the nick point. But surprisingly, when we first did soil excavation in 2009, and we found that regardless of the erosion rate, we found that soil thickness, even though they are variable, don't change much, and they are quite consistent. So this year, we came back to the site with more sophisticated tool, and then ogred around, and then calibrated ogreing depths with our pit measurement, and did the same measurement. We came back with the same data that suggests the soil thickness don't really vary across this erosion gradient. And this year, Manny Gabay also brought his mighty probe and poked around the landscape several hundred times. And then even though the data seemed to suggest that there is some decrease of soil thickness, actually the data says the same thing. The only reason there seemed to be a trend is because palm site have many of the very thick soils, and which is probably because the mighty probe could penetrate into the weak saprolite that seems to be only present at the pump, and that the BRC, the soils are very rocky. So those mighty probe touch the rock and then give us the soil depths based on the rock depths. So so relatively constant soil thickness across the tenfold increase in denudation rate. And why is that? And then, so our working hypothesis is that that is probably because of a weak saprolite and trees. And we have some limited, but some of it of support for those which I'm going to present to you now. So this is the thickness of the saprolite. And then over these ridges, we have two the ogreing operations. On this ridge, we are able to auger down to 8.4 meter, but it was still saprolite, and we just stopped because our field time didn't permit us to continue. And then also we had another ogreing operation at the ridge near the FTA and the BRC. We also had more than 5 meter depths, and which we could go on probably forever. And then at the lower hill slope, however, at the back slope at the palm, we have ogre refusal depths at the 4 meter. And that speaking of ogre refusal depths, and that they tend to be about 2 to 3 meter or 1 meter in FTA and the BRC. And we think that one reason we have such really deep depths at the saprolite is because we are probably drilling into the old relict landscape, because this high rich landscape have not felt the incision signal that was X-rayed over the last 4 to 5 million years. So now I'm going to show you some saprolite materials from PAMD and FTA and BRC. And at the palm, the saprolite materials, by the time it emerges into the soil, are very clay rich, and then which are really chemically altered and very pliable. But compared to the saprolite at the palm and the BRC saprolite, actually has a more significant rock textures, and it lacks significant clay contents that we observed at the pond. So when we look at the chemical weathering, and the particularly mass loss of the silicon and calcium and other elements, and I'm pulling out two elements here, and they show that the progressive chemical dissolution leaching of elements as the saprolite migrate toward the surface as the materials above are being denuded. So putting all those measurements into a conceptual figure, and then this is the summary conceptual figure, and then the x-axis is the depth of the weathering profile, and the y-axis is the critical shear stress that is required to break down the saprolite. And then up way above here, then we have the critical shear stress of the fresh bedrock. And let's think about the saprolite at the palm. And the palm saprolite started from the fresh rock at certain depths, which we don't know yet. And then it progressively weathers, and as chemical weathering continues, the saprolite loses its strengths. But then at the higher denudation site in FTA and BRC, the depth to the fresh bedrock is probably shallower, and then it continued to weather, and then they also lose their strengths. But then now let's bring in the biophysical agent that physically break down the saprolite. So in this conceptual figure, you have colluvial soils only where the shear strength that is provided by the biology exceed the critical shear strength that is required to break down the saprolite. So if we have a system where that biological shear stress exponentially decreases with the depth as described here, then we may have soils only at the pump, and then soil thickness will decrease with increasing erosion rate, and we may have exposed the bedrock in FDA and BRC, for example. But if the shear stress by the tree roots abruptly decrease at a certain depth, then we may continue to have soils within a certain range as we move from the highly denuding landscape to slowly denuding landscape to highly denuding landscapes. And that's probably where we are at the Fed River. So in summary, so where do all those lead us to place a separate weathering in the context of landscape evolution? And I think that denudation not only affects probably the soil thickness, but also significantly affects the thickness of a saprolite, and thus control the residence time of the minerals through the saprolite, which dramatically affects the chemical weathering, and such that also as separate chemically weathered, their rock strength is also diminishes, and which have direct control on the soil production. So then on top of all those geomorphic and geochemical and geological processes, and we have biological processes that actually brings the power shear stress to the rock materials and which created the soil. So I hope I made some strong case for studying whole weathering profile to really understand the landscape evolution in response to tectonics. And with that, and I acknowledge my invincible and fun collaborators, and also appreciate the financial support from National Science Foundation that made all this work possible. And thank you.
Thank you, Kyung-Soo. So just before our last talk, I want to thank all the speakers in this session, the seven, and I want to highlight especially the invited talks, Genevieve, Anne, Kyung-Soo, and our last speaker, Brian. So before we end, I want to encourage people to stay and chat with the speakers during the break at 10 o'clock. I want to briefly remind the audience on behalf of Paul Cutler that he'll be available. He's the Geomorphology and Land Use Dynamics Program Manager at SF. He'll be at the NSED booth today from 3 to 4. And then I want to go forward today. The last talk is Brian McGlynn and his colleagues, and the title of the talk is Implications of Water Life Landform Feedbacks for Terrestrial Carbon Cycling, Organization and Scaling of Carbon and Water Landscape Dynamics in Complex Landscapes.
Well, thank you very much and welcome. I'm presenting work that represents the work of colleagues and students, Ryan Emanuel, Diego Rivera-Seregui, and Howie Epstein. And quite a long title, and I apologize, but I'm going to talk a little bit today about water life and landforms, and specifically how landscape evolution is influenced by the history of water distribution, energy, and life interactions, and how they set the context or the stage for contemporary landscape pattern and processes. So my talk today will focus on contemporary dynamics, but it's informed by the history of the land. So when we look at this photo on the background, we see a forest, we see a landscape, we see mountain ranges, and all of us will see something different, but unquestionably we see topography and we see relief. And we can imagine that this is going to affect surface energy balances, the distribution and redistribution of water, and we see vegetation on the surface that represents some interaction of those two things, the water and the energy balance. Today I'm going to focus on carbon and how landforms and water mediate soil respiration across the landscape, and how they also affect vegetation distribution, and how the intersection of those things controls the carbon balance. And I'd like to follow and bring it full circle by talking about how vegetation and life in turn affect water and how that might manifest as differences in stream flow and landscape connectivity. Oops. So we have both non-local and local controls on behavior. So we can imagine local controls being one-dimensional processes that we typically start with our modeling work. But neither energy nor water nor vegetation is purely affected by local dynamics. Things that are happening upslope or transported can affect local behavior. For example, if we think about water, we have rainfall or snowmelt on a specific spot in the landscape, but it's also the redistribution of water from upslope positions that affects local water conditions. And that redistribution is not only affected by topography and gradients, but by potential extractions such as transpiration and evaporation that might be happening in upslope positions. So I've chosen to focus on the Tenderfoot Creek Experimental Forest. It's located in central Montana, just as an example of this life, landform, and water feedback situation. It's a mountain environment with about just a little bit less than 1,000 millimeters of annual precipitation, essentially one snowmelt event per year, and a long seasonal dry down. Soil depths are shallow. The average annual temperature is about 0 degrees. And I'll be focusing on the upper watershed in this position here. So what this map represents in yellow to purple is the landscape redistribution of water. It's just a simple flow accumulation algorithm to give us some sense of where water is moving on the landscape and where it's coming from and where it's accumulating. And layered on top of that are sampling locations. 62 of them are locations where we measured soil respiration or carbon dioxide efflux from the soil to the atmosphere. And I should note that there are two flux towers in a riparian position and an upland position, and they'll come into play later. And so the question is how does landscape structure and its effect, or how does it redistribute water on the landscape, and does this affect carbon dynamics such as respiration? In addition, one can think about the surface energy balance and the fact that based on slope and aspect and their combination, each position on this landscape is receiving a different amount of energy, and which in turn might manifest as differences in temperature. So, this graphic represents the point scale cumulative efflux across the about 500 hectare watershed here. So it's cumulative efflux of grams of CO2 on the y-axis, time on the x-axis across 62 landscape positions indicated by the black dots. And what we see is a sevenfold variation in cumulative growing season CO2 efflux depending upon where you are in the landscape. The question is then, how does this relate to landscape variables? And I should note that the red and blue lines on that map are also nighttime respiration inferred from eddy covariance towers located in riparian and upslope landscape positions. And we see that they fall somewhere within the range of our point measurements, which is good. But the question is, how do those point measurements integrate to a landscape level response? Well, taken all 62 points and broken them up by aspect because of differences in soil temperature depending upon whether or not we're on southeast or northwest slopes. And what we find is that upslope accumulated area, or how much area and water drains to a specific point on the landscape, that this can explain 65 and 61% of the variability we see in cumulative growing season efflux. And the difference in slope is a function of the differences in temperature on these two slopes. And so it looks like the spatial pattern of respiration is influenced by both water and temperature, which are largely mediated by landform. And this is just the spatial expression of that pattern, so extrapolating from those regression relationships by upslope accumulated area, and we see a landscape pattern like this. And so this landscape is anything but uniform, and it's largely influenced, again, by landform. This essentially is following topographic redistribution of water as well as its effect on the surface energy balance. So we can look at this, and here's our eddy covariance tower, and this is just another color scheme of the same information. And our seasonal efflux is on the order of 12 moles of CO2 per meter squared over that growing season. But the eddy covariance tower is measuring one value. It's measuring at night. We can try to infer what respiration is, but it just gives us one value. It gives us 12. But we can see from the spatial map as well as the histogram that the landscape ranges anything from less than 5 moles of CO2 to well over 18 moles of CO2. And so again, our tower gives us one value. The structure of the landscape is mediating or controlling that distribution across the land. At the same time, the tower is largely giving us the net carbon balance. And we can try to infer respiration from nighttime measurements, but it's giving the net carbon balance. And it's integrating, in this case, over time. And it's integrating the effects of soil moisture decline, indicated in red, so a soil influence on carbon dynamics, as well as an atmospheric control, indicated by vapor pressure deficit in blue, leading to a daily NEP dynamic across the season and a cumulative sink behavior for this whole landscape. So I'm going to suggest that we can use landscape structure and vegetation structure to try to disaggregate those integrated tower fluxes into their controls. I've already talked about the landscape influence on respiration, and now I'd like to talk about its integration with vegetation influence on gross primary productivity or photosynthesis. So the spatial pattern of respiration across the landscape and its histogram represented in the lower left corner. At the same time, we can disaggregate tower fluxes into the by using the structure of the vegetation by inferring primary productivity from leaf area index and vegetation height, and get an idea of the spatial distribution of photosynthesis across the land. And now the net ecosystem productivity, or the source sink status of the landscape, is going to be controlled by the intersection of respiration out of the system and photosynthesis and uptake into the system, giving us a net balance across the landscape. And so this intersection between subsurface processes of microbial and root respiration and above ground processes of photosynthesis lead to a more complex spatial pattern of net ecosystem productivity or carbon sink across the landscape. It's interesting to note, though, that the tower is measuring in this order about 160 grams of CO2, whereas there are locations on the landscape that are up to a source up to 1,000 grams, or a sink up to almost 3,000 grams. Again, our tower is one measure. The landscape mediates its distribution of the component pieces across the land, and it's the intersection of two processes, vegetation and subsurface processes, that mediate the balance of the two. Next, I'd like to think about how life, as indicated here by respiration in trees, might in turn affect water. So I've already suggested that water affects life. Now let's think about how life might affect water. So on the left graphic, this is the same watershed. Now the colors indicate the length of the flow pathways from a point in the landscape to the stream network. One might think about this as a spatial description of the width function. And it's essentially just flow path lengths across the landscape. Red areas have a long distance to travel before they get to the stream. Blue areas have a shorter distance to travel before they get to the stream. And on the right, it's vegetation height. And if we consider that the question is, how does vegetation influence water redistribution, connectivity, and manifest as differences in stream flow? So flow path length, and along any given flow path, one might think about vegetation as a potential extraction of water from that flow path to the atmosphere. And so one might think in a non-vegetated landscape or a place where there was no evaporation or transpiration that received rain, that flow path length would control the distribution of water and its pathway to the stream. With ET, though, anywhere along that flow pathway, there's an opportunity for extraction to the atmosphere. And the more frequent the vegetation is along any given flow path, the more likely that water is extracted and doesn't eventually make it to the stream. And so we can model this. And I'm going to show three time points at high flow, medium flow, and low flow, indicated by green, yellow, and red, and evapotranspiration for the whole system, indicated in blue below. We want to again ask this question of what's the influence of vegetation on landscape hydrologic connectivity and stream flow dynamics. And so what I'm showing in three maps across the center is in early season, when things are wettest, we have active saturation and the potential for the redistribution of water across the entire landscape. But as the season progresses and energy increases and evaporation and transpiration increase, the vegetation then can modify that active, from a stream's point of view, portion of the landscape, leading to a collapse of the effective watershed area. And the pattern that emerges from, again, high, medium, and low flow, or early snowmelt, mid snowmelt, and late snowmelt, is this feedback of vegetation back to the hydrologic system that is manifested partially in the change in the hydrograph and through base flow recession. And so my first example, I talked about how water, life, and landforms feed back in terms of the carbon balance of respiration to the atmosphere, photosynthesis, the net balance, and how, again, landforms and water mediate life, and in this case, the carbon balance across the land. And again, how they impart each a fundamental structure that's manifest in a map like this. And then, in second, I asked how vegetation, in turn, affects water dynamics, right? Because we know that evaporation and transpiration have a large withdrawal, and in this watershed, 60% of the annual precipitation leaves to the atmosphere via evaporation and transpiration. And this is the pattern, or the template, or the signature it imparts on the landscape, as represented by low-flow connectivity. So in whole, I've hoped that I've given an example of the feedbacks and tried to close the loop. And one thing I have left out, though, I must admit, is then how vegetation in turn affects water availability for respiration. But we have tried to close the loop and just suggesting that the structure of the landform, that's the temporal manifestation of the history of water, life, geology, et cetera, imparts a contemporary template upon which processes and patterns operate. Thank you very much for your time and attention.